Good morning, everyone. We extend a very warm welcome to you all. I can also extend a warm welcome to any visitors who are here and anyone listening online. We hope to enjoy the service this morning. A few intimations, if you bear with me. First, after the meeting, after the service today, we'll be having our annual steady meeting for the church. I'd like as many, obviously, to stay behind as possible. Only takes about 15, 20 minutes after our talks at the very most. So just after the service, you just come forward toward the front of the church and we'll have the meeting thereafter. It's just one of these kind of administrative things we've got to do, so a good attendance would be appreciated. The guild meets tomorrow at 1:30 in the hall, and the lady that's coming tomorrow to speak to him is Irene Pick. And it's an interesting one. She's talking about life before the telly. I can't remember when after the project. So that should be quite an interesting one. And they're also having their guest night on Monday the 28th of March at 7 p.m. It's the Caledonian Fiddle Orchestra that are coming along. Again, it's open to everyone in the church to come along if you wish. If you were to come along too, could you, whenever you get a chance, could you give Liz or Sheena, giving the name so you can make an entrance for Katie. So that's Monday the 28th of March, 7 p.m. in the church hall, and it's a Scottish Fiddle Orchestra. So it should be a good evening. And as I say, if you want to come along, give Liz Morton your name. The Daffodil Tea, we'll be holding the Daffodil Tea on Saturday the 2nd of April, between 1 o'clock and 3 o'clock. Tickets are now available for any fundraising team, they're priced at £5. And if anyone wishes to attend the nations of homemaking, it would be greatly appreciated. So it's Saturday the 2nd of April, between 1 and 3, the Daffodil Tea. And just a prior notice, we've got to go yet. On Monday the 30th of May, Aaron Guy is having a closed show, an exposed show down at Robert's Neighbourhood Centre, and we'll get more details of that to follow. And lastly, you made a call last week and the week before, we were preparing an offering for the Ukrainian Bible Society. Thanks to everyone who contributed, and the sum of £336.21 was raised. So thank you very much indeed for a very worthwhile cause. Just to remind you all, next Saturday night the clocks go forward 1 hour. So don't be far up here at 10 o'clock, I'll be 12 o'clock. next Saturday night, the clocks go forward 1 hour. Thank you very much indeed.
Come praise the eternal God and all that is within us, body More than any doctor, he heals our diseases. When we are famished and weak, he fills us with good and beautiful things, satisfying our needs and restoring our strength. So come, come praise the eternal God. Sing songs from a grateful heart and remember all that he has done for us. Continue in praise of God as we sing together, Lord Jesus, think on me.
Those who have preceded us and those who will follow after us.
Those who are scattered right around the world to declare your praise and lose themselves in loving wonder of who you are. Our words are familiar, for they are drawn from a rich, honored, trusted tradition down throughout the gift of scripture and hymn writer, poet, and artist. There have been those who have plummeted the mystery of divine love and have sought to offer some way in which we can express our gratitude and thanksgiving. So we thank you for the ways in which your Spirit has inspired them. But even were all the world and all the words offered us, our prayers would not do you justice. So we come, as is appropriate, often simply to still our lives, in light of that remarkable sentiment of the hymn writer, that you who have revealed yourself in Jesus Christ, loving Saviour, Healer, and Lord, will think on us, will focus your loving gaze upon us, will examine us, yes, with that tenderness that reminds us that we belong to you, the Living One. We find our life and love renewed in you. So in the silence, we gather who we are. Where there have been storms, Lord, in the week that has passed, storms that have tried and tested us, storms that have reminded us of our vulnerability and failure, storms that have reminded us indeed that this world and our place in it is often an unpredictable place. Come, still the storms in our life, and restore us to loving union with you, the God who knows us best and loves us most. Where there has been darkness and struggle, where at times you have been tempted to stay in bed, times you literally have stayed in bed, where we have struggled to face the challenges of the day, where we have felt ourselves cut off and isolated, come and restore within us a reminder that we are created for loving relationships, that we are created in such a way that indeed we are marked by the sacred presence of God, that our lives have incredible value, for they are a gift from the God who is love. And where we have bowed it out to face the day without care or thought or consideration, we have launched ourselves into the lives of others, sometimes taking them for granted, sometimes speaking words that have brought great woundedness and misunderstanding, sometimes in our excessive enthusiasm have overlooked the call and invitation to listen and truly be present to each other. Come and still our hearts in this moment, that of this hour it might indeed be a sacred and fresh encounter with you, the God who forgives and loves and heals. Come and meet with us by your Spirit. So, Lord Jesus, we come to give glory to your Father, the Creator of all that there is. In the power of the Spirit we gather, for indeed we are constantly being made new by your love that transforms us in our waking and in our sleeping. You're the God constantly inviting us to life and love. And so we pray that even in this hour of worship and thanksgiving, confession and renewed experience of your grace, we might go from this place as those indeed with reason to celebrate the goodness and graciousness of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who in the Son taught us to pray the prayer that has now become familiar. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 to 15. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw, though the bush was in fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight. Why the bush does not burn up? When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, Here I am. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face, because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go. I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you, and this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. Moses said to God, Suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, The God of your fathers has sent me to you. And they ask me, What is his name? Then what shall I tell them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you have to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, Say to the Israelites, The Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, the name you shall call me from generation to generation. Amen. And thanks be to God for the reading of his holy words.
We sing in response to God's word, O God, you search me and you know. to Moses, I am who I am, which is a polite way of saying, mind your own business. Let God be God, and we respond to God. And so the season of Lent is just such a season. It's a season of invitation. It's a reminder that we come to a story that is familiar and tried and true. We've heard this story many times if we have had any lengthy association with the rhythms of the worshipping life of the church. We come to familiar passages throughout the season of Lent this year, happening to find ourselves in year C, which is a focus particularly on Luke's gospel, but it's the various ways in which light is shed on the human experience in the midst of the many and varied questions we ask. I am who I am, let God be God, and let God address each one of us in the experience of our lives as they are, but also hopefully as we would want them to be. There's often a gap, but we pray that Lent be a time of reflection, repentance, and reorientation. It's a time of discovering afresh that God is still busy with us. And so the gospel reading is from Luke chapter 13, the first 9 verses. That time some people were there who told Jesus about the Galileans who Pilate had killed while they were offering sacrifices to God. Jesus answered them, "Because these Galileans were killed in that way, do you think it proves that they were worse sinners than all the other Galileans? No, indeed. And I tell you that if you do not turn from your sins, you will all die as they did. What about those 18 people in Siloam who were killed when the tower fell on them? Do you suppose this proves that they were worse than all the other people living in Jerusalem? No, indeed. And I tell you that if you do not turn from your sins, you will all die as they did." Then Jesus told them this parable. There was once a man who had a fig tree growing in his vineyard. He went looking for figs on it, but found none. So he said to his gardener, "Look, for 3 years I've been coming here looking for figs on this fig tree and I haven't found any. Cut it down. Why should it go on using up the soil?" But the gardener answered, "Leave it alone, sir. Just one more year. I will dig round it and put in some manure. Then if the tree bears fruits next year, so much the better. If not, then you can cut it down." It's an amazing experience of being human. I don't know how often you reflect on it. Every now and again, it's just shuddering, really. I always think of my own parents on that night, and I wonder what they were thinking of, and maybe they had an argument. Maybe it was makeup sex. Who knows? I don't know, maybe it was after a romantic dinner, candlelit, dancing. Maybe it was just, well, we're bored, let's make a baby. I don't know. Thank goodness I never asked. I've had either the wisdom or the courage. But miraculously, on that particular day, in that particular moment, my little boys won. And boom, 9 months later, I was here. A miracle of being alive. A miracle of being human. Plunged into an experience of life in the midst of life as it really is. I didn't ask to be here. I had nothing to do with that day or night or afternoon when they were making rupee, as we say. Nothing. They didn't ask my permission. They just inflicted me upon the world. And then they said, "Well, we'll do our best being parents in the midst of all the other things that bother us, paying off the mortgage, going to work, trying to make ends meet." And in the midst of all the mumble and the jumble, eventually we become who we are. And it is amazing when we look at the biblical record to be reminded that that is exactly where God intersects with life. The wonderful thing about the biblical narrative is that is where the time meets the talk. God meets people as they are in the context of their living. And so even the calling of the so-called holy ones, the prophets, happens there. It happens while they're going about their business. It happens in the context of the events that have helped shape them. It happens not in isolation or in a vacuum. For Moses, he's just a shepherd. If you know the story, he's trying to recover. He was one who grew up in the courts of Pharaoh, as the story goes. And one day he sees someone mistreating a person, so he kills a guard. And then the next day people find out that he's done it, and they threaten to report him. And before you know it, he's rushed into the wilderness and he spends years, decades there, just trying to find himself, trying to recover, for want of a better expression, tending sheep. And you know how it happens. You see a burning bush. You know you should ignore it, because burning bushes are dangerous. Don't go and look at what's happening in a burning bush. Naturally, the so-called experts tell us these things happen all the time. Bushes self-combust, a combination of the heat and the atmosphere in which they find themselves. But for Moses, it's a divine encounter. Suddenly, in the presence of the holy bush, the burning bush, he finds he's on holy ground. Remove your sandals. The God who created heaven and earth is going to address him. He makes all the excuses. If God ever tackles you in your life, make sure you come with a notebook of excuses. Because you're really going to need them. I'm too old, too skinny, too overweight. I don't look right, I don't speak properly. I've come from the wrong class, wrong culture. Come with your excuses. And God wears Moses down. And then eventually that is that moment, which is the theme for today. Well, can you tell me who you are? What is your name? I am who I am. Politely, mind your own business. Let me be God and you be Moses. That's what happens in Lent. We come and remind ourselves throughout the season of Lent that we are dust and ash, and to dust and ash we shall return. We come and remind ourselves of our mortality and our vulnerability and our humanity. We come to remind ourselves that we are not angels, but are human beings. We come to remind ourselves that we make wrong decisions, find ourselves in wrong places, and God leads us out into places of liberation. We come to remind ourselves that we are part of a living, continued exodus, moving from those places of enslavement and oppression and all sorts of wrong choices in the direction of liberation and life and God and freedom and wide open spaces, the land of milk and honey. But we're going to be bruised along the way. We're going to find it difficult. And one of the most difficult things about being human, if not the most difficult, why do bad things happen to good people? I need you to hesitate if I ask you to put up your hand and consider yourself a good person. But I suppose I put up my hand. I think I'm a good person. Not a perfect person. Not a wonderful person. But a good person. I try to be good. I've tried to be good from very young. I try to listen to what the so-called experts tell me. From my grandmother in the earliest years, to my parents, to teachers, to all sorts of people. Hey, I've tried to be good. Promises. And the problem is, a lot of bad things happen even to so-called good people. If you spend any length of time paying attention to the headlines or the reality of lived human experience, you find that there are so many things that cannot be explained. And so we too also, not only to the theme of I am who I am, but the very presence, the embodiment of that promise of God in Jesus Christ, and the profound wisdom and engagement that Jesus has with the world in which we live. He is and offers the alternate vision of God's loving and gracious presence. So people come to and ask the age-old question, the question that if it's not on the tip of our tongue, is there in the back of our minds on a regular basis. Why is it, for instance, that one dictator can declare war on one country and cause untold havoc? Why is it that some people, just by the reason of their access to military weapons, can cause so much disaster? Why is it that some people, just because they live in the wrong area, can be exposed to natural disasters time and time again, whether it's flooding, earthquakes, famine? Why is it? Why is it that some people seem to have so much and other people have so little? Why is it? Why is it that these people go to worship intending to offer their sacrifices to God and they are crushed, they are killed, Pilate makes a mockery of them? Why is it that the tower falls at Siloam? Why is it? It's the age-old problem, the age-old difficulty. Jesus is very frustrating. He doesn't give us a comprehensive answer. And that's the difficulty about engaging Jesus during the season of Lent. That's the difficulty of having a conversation with Jesus. Because you never get the definitive answer, but rather you get further questions that ask you about your engagement with life and with suffering, your responsibility in the midst of the human tendency, and we're all find ourselves facing this temptation, and none of us are completely immune, because deep within us, we're almost hardwired to believe, well, if something bad happened to you, you probably deserved it. There's something in your life that you did. You didn't tell anyone, but it's there. You probably deserved it. It's almost wired into us. So Jesus does not go down the rabbit hole. Doesn't get distracted. He rather says, no, you repent. You turn your life in the direction of God. You allow yourself to be held accountable by the mystery of the God who simply is. I am who I am. And then he tells them a story. Because Jesus always tells stories. It's so frustrating with Jesus. Because in many ways, Jesus is not like many ministers and theologians and experts and professionals who try to explain everything away, who try to tell us what we're about, why we're here, what we're supposed to be doing, what we're supposed to be thinking, how we're supposed to be behaving. Jesus tells us stories. He tells a story about a fig tree. And he says, this fig tree is not bearing much fruit. And it's a funny story, because on one level it makes absolutely no sense. And we don't know actually what the meaning of the story is. But it's almost the story of Lent. Give it one more year. Give them one more chance. Give them one more opportunity. Give them one more week. Give them one more month. Give them one more year. And then within a year we'll come back and see if the fig tree has borne fruit or whether we should cut it down. And so Lent is basically the long, repeated patience of God. Saying it's never too late to change your mind about what really matters. In the midst of all the questions, the pain, the anguish, the reality of life and living, the headlines, the crushing of the human spirit, the many times we've failed and fallen and are vulnerable, the many times in which we have been tempted to give up, hear the season of Lent. I am who I am. You are being invited by the living, gracious, compassionate God. You're being challenged and strengthened by that self-same God to live out the gospel, to live out good news, to be a sign of hope and freedom and love and liberation. You are precious. You are valued. You are gift. And so on this Sunday we come back to that question, which was right at the beginning of Lent. Where is God in all of this? Where is God in all of this? Old Hebrew imagination were very hesitant to name God. Much of the scriptures eventually became the definition Lord as we have it. It was just Yahweh without the consonants. There was the sense in which it was such a sacred name that old Hebrews believed that if you named something, you had power over it. Sound familiar? We in the modern world have been naming everything. Absolutely everything. Everything has a category. Everything has a box. Everything has a label. Right down to every species and subspecies. We are incredibly good at naming things. You are this, not that. You fit in here, not there. You belong here, you belong there. These are the good ones, these are the bad ones. Categorizing, naming. The Hebrews said, no. With God, let God be God. Don't be too quick to think you're God and you know what's on God's mind and whose side God is on. But rather allow yourself to be those people open to the way in which God wants to address you. Lent is a humbling time. We are dust and ash and full of sin, as many of our hymns have reminded us on this glorious Sunday. But we are also precious and sacred and being invited to life. And so in this coming week, as we continue in the season of Lent, do something, anything, no matter how small, that speaks of the commitment that you have to life and love. Listen just a little bit longer. Lent is always a season for listening, for gazing at burning bushes, for finding ourselves in the presence of the one who knows us, creates us, shapes us. Repent. Repent from all those things. Turn from those things that frustrate the will of God and life and justice and mercy in your life. And reorientate yourself around that which leads in the direction of life and love and grace and goodness and forgiveness and new beginnings. And finally, be patient. You're not finished yet. Neither am I. If truth be told, we probably, well, maybe never will be. And that's part of the fun. We become those who God intends us to become, step by step, day by day, week by week, month by month, and year by year. We're in a familiar season. It's Lent. And on one level at least, it's always a new season. New beginnings, new possibilities. We come to pray. Let us pray. Lord, we do not even know where to begin with our prayers. The thundering sense of your presence, the gift of Moses in a burning bush, I am who I am, the God who is the Father of the ancestors, Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, is the God who addresses us in the context of our history, our lived experience, and we find ourselves plunged in the midst of life, here in the 21st century. Here we are. We find ourselves barraged by images of struggle and suffering, war and conflict, Russia, Ukraine, anguish, illness, virus, earthquakes, volcanoes, floods, famines. Where shall we begin? Lord, we come and begin where you invite us to begin. Take off our shoes. For we are standing on holy ground to recognize that it is an amazing privilege to even be in this place and at this time to offer our prayers. To acknowledge that no matter what words we use or don't use, you already know our hearts and everything about us. You know what we long for. You know what we pray for. You know what we hope for. So in the act of public worship, we come to bring all of that to you. We pray for this world and our experience of life in the midst of it. We thank you for moments of grace and encouragement where people opened homes to refugees and immigrants, where we ourselves have been able to raise over £300 for the Ukrainian World Bible Society, for moments of relief either through the offering of medical assistance or sometimes even military aid. The reminders that even when we live in a vulnerable world, we can all do something, no matter how small. We pray too for the sense of our life here in the United Kingdom. We pray particularly once again for the reminder of fragility of economy, with P&O, and the sudden, dare we say, almost violent action of retrenching people. A reminder of lives that will be impacted, families that will increasingly become anxious, people will wonder where their next wage comes from. In light of increased living costs as we journey toward April, the spiraling out of control of costs around fuel and gas and oil and heating and food, and yes, a reminder, Lord, that we pray for our lives here in this glorious island, where we long to experience something of that grace, mercy, compassion. compassionate community that speaks of sharing love and new beginnings. We pray for our leadership, our government, we pray for those who work in labour on the local level. And finally, Lord, we pray for the church, us, part of this glorious family, this unpredictable reminder that you are still at work in the world by the gift of your Spirit. And soon, yes, in a few minutes, we will be celebrating through our annual state of meeting some of the ways in which you have worked through us, some of the ways in which people have dedicated their lives, their gifts, their offerings. We will celebrate that, and we will thank you that we've been here for one more year. For it is year by year that we experience something of your grace and your healing. We pray particularly for those who feel themselves vulnerable at this point in time, for those who are easily and readily overlooked, for those who are housebound and isolated either by reason of COVID or other pressing circumstances, for those who grieve and who are buffeted by life's challenges. Lord, we come to dedicate our lives and our prayers to you and pray that indeed you might hear them, and that you, the Lord of sea and sky, hearing our prayers, will lead us in turn back into the world to live out our lives of faith, hope, and love. In Jesus' strong name we pray. Amen. I, the Lord of sea and sky, is our closing hymn. And I do remind you, as our session clock did, that there will be the annual state committee straight after this act of worship. the Holy Spirit be with us all, evermore. Amen.